Good friend Ravi has also been teaching architecture as a visiting faculty for over 13 years now, having been associated with the RV College of Engineering and Dayanand Sagar Institutions. Welcome Ravi to our show today.
Certainly Mr. Balaji, it's always a pleasure to interact with a professional realtor like yourselves, because you are day to day, you are in touch with the needs and changing requirements of your clients. And to engage with such a professional person, all the questions that you asked are questions that we come across every day when every client approaches us. So they are very, very valid, and even more so now, very, very, very true because of everything that social media offers us and the current scenario, the situation that puts us in. So I think extremely valid. It's always a pleasure to engage with a professional like you. I look forward to it. Thank you.
All our audiences are waiting. So let us jump to our first question, which is, first of all, what does an architect actually do and why do we need an architect?
Okay, so Mr. Balaji, thank you for having me. And the basic concept here is that construction is a very, very involved process involving hundreds of components and thousands of variables. And when somebody wants to construct, it's good to take professional help from a person who can advise you about all these options and variables. It's like we try to do something ourselves, it could work, but you're taking a chance. And we're making a large investment, how much of a chance do you want to take? Now the architect basically uses his or her experience to help translate your designs into a set of drawings and designs that different agencies working at the site can understand, so that what you actually have dreamt or want can be made into a building. So basically they're translating your wishes, your aspirations into drawings that can be understood by a third person and made into reality. And the architect advises you about the pros and cons of all those hundreds and thousands of choices available to you, advises you understanding what are the advantages of each of those materials and products, so that you're getting the best value for the money that you're putting into the building.
So typical questions all my clients used to ask, what are the trending designs of houses built on a typical sizes today available in Bangalore, like 30, 40s, 40, 60s and 50, 80s, and what you feel is trending?
So this is a very interesting question, and I think people have gone to Instagram and Google and all to try to answer this question, to try to work it out. The thing is, there is actually no such thing as trending, because each house is a reflection of the personality of the owner. Each office or residential building is a reflection of the owner's personality, and just as there are, each person is different, each house or office needs to be different. So actually, trending is more about what is working for you today. What are your priorities? What are your preferences today? And what is trending for you today may be very different from what was trending for you maybe 2 years or 5 years or 10 years ago, depending on where you are in life and what your priorities are. So I think we define trending by understanding our customers, by understanding their needs, and also understanding where they're going to go further, because a building, this house, is going to last you for 20, 25, 30, maybe 50 years. And it needs to continue to adapt to your changes. It needs to continue to remain trending over time. So trending is whatever you need today.
Got it. So many of my clients either like or hate when they actually look at the elevation of the house for the first time. And can you tell us how important is that and what are the trending designs again?
Yeah, so I think elevation is very important, because it's like a first impression. Just like we tend to judge people on first impressions when we meet somebody, we look at a person, look at the personality, the dress, the way they speak, we look at them and we judge them. So too, when you first see a building, the elevation is what you see, the facade is what you see. Even before you go inside, you judge the building based on what you see from the outside. So I think it is extremely important, because that is the first impression, and you're already prepared by looking at it from outside. You're prepared to like it or hate it even before you've gone inside. So it is extremely important. But again, as far as the trending matter is concerned, I think it's again up to the individual sensibilities and preferences. There are people who like English, Elizabethan, Victorian houses, and they want that style to be followed. There are people who like Spanish villas, and they love those, or Roman style. And then the people who want to go for modern or postmodern. So can I say that any of these are right or wrong? I don't think so. These are all individual styles. It's like, you know, you wear dresses that you enjoy wearing and that you feel you look good in. There's no right or wrong there. Similarly, the facade of elevation, to say trending, it's again a difficult terminology, but to say that yes, it needs to meet the aspirations of the owner, the person who's in the house, the user. And I think if that person is happy, then you should not worry about what so many other people say, because everybody will either like it or dislike it.
Understood. So trending will not be there anymore in our questions. So having said that, we have seen so many developers coming out with a 3 BHK flat at less than 750 square foot, and the area is shrinking day by day. According to you, yes, what are the recommended sizes for each spaces, like living, kitchen, bathrooms and bedrooms? And could you explain on that, please?
Yeah, sure. I think the first thing that people need to understand is they make the mistake of comparing a 1750 square feet in an independent house to a 1750 square feet in an apartment. Now, that is a mistake, because in the independent house, you get far more carpet area per square foot of built area as compared to an apartment. In an independent house, the only extra areas that you have are your walls. Whereas in an apartment, you have other common spaces, circulation spaces, lift, staircase, blah, blah, blah. So the proportionate carpet area that you get in the apartment is much smaller. And that is something people don't. People think, oh, 1750 square feet apartment I'm staying in, if I move into a 1750 square feet independent house, it's going to be something similar. No, it will be maybe 20-30% larger. That is the first thing. As far as the size of rooms are concerned, I think it would depend on the individual families, on the makeup of the family. Is it a joint family? How many members are there? Are they seniors? Are they small children? So depending on that, if it's a large joint family, then common areas are very important. Places where people gather, maybe the dining hall, a living room where people sit together, they want to watch TV together, they want to eat together. These spaces are very important because people spend a lot of time in these common spaces. Whereas if it is a maybe young, upcoming self-employed couple, maybe for them, the workspaces, the bedroom areas, the, you know, kitchen being a very, very compact, simple kitchen, because most likely they're going to be out most of the day and, you know, it has a very simple functional kitchen. So the kitchen sort of takes a back seat. The workspaces take a front seat, and also their ability to entertain guests, entertain friends. So that takes a front seat. So again, these proportion of these spaces will have to be, they have to remain proportionate to each other. Proportion of the living room, to the bedroom, to the kitchen, to the bathroom, there has to be a certain proportion so that you don't end up with a huge hall and a very small bedroom, or vice versa. But having said that, we usually design this based on the specific needs of the people, where they are and what the family is like, and therefore how they will use the space. For example, sometimes people say, I don't want a TV in my living room, I'll have it in my bedroom. That changes the dynamics of the bedroom. Or they say that, no, we all, you know, sort of get together, we'll all have dinner together. So it changes the dynamics of the dining room. So it changes these things. The exact sizes will depend on the family. But based on the family setup, we usually have a proportion for the spaces. And that proportion must work well. You must not end up with spaces too large or too small. I hope I've answered that question.
I got that. So I think most of the audience would be looking at a very specific measurements, like a kitchen being 8x10. Or I think they will understand by what you have said right now. So going to the next question, when it comes to the interiors, the list is endless. Could you take us through what should be the part of the house which is like must have, and what are those which we could eliminate while planning the interiors, and why?
I believe that it's extremely important that your interior should be very, very flexible and should be able to adapt to your changing needs, because the house as a shell, as an envelope, will last you for a very long time. But your needs over time will change. Like if you have a small child at home, you need to make the spaces very child friendly, where the child cannot hurt himself or herself. No sharp corners, no glass edges. But as the children grow, their interests, their hobbies come into the picture. What do they like doing? What keeps them going? What do they enjoy? And that has to be incorporated into the house. And maybe at one point of time, the children fly the nest, and then it's only the couple. And now, how do you maintain the house? You don't want such a large space. You don't want space which is difficult to maintain. How do you maintain the house? So the house keeps changing because the family keeps changing. Now it's very important that the interior should be designed in a flexible manner so that they can change with a minimum effort to these changing needs. So I think the interior is like the second envelope inside the shell, and that will keep changing based on answers and the needs of the family.
The common belief is that architects are costly and they push up the cost of the construction. What would you say to this?
Actually, this is one of the biggest myths. And people believe that one, hiring an architect, why should we pay the extra fee to the architect? We can save that money. And second, they believe that, you know, if an architect is involved, they'll push up the cost in order to feed their own ego. So they want a grand house that they can show to others and say, look, this one I designed. So these are two very common myths. Actually, architects save money. Architects save more money than you spend on their fee. How they do this is because an architect is involved, he or she will help you design your space, understanding what you need. And you will end up making less changes or making less mistakes when you're building the house. So there'll be less rework. They will also advise you about the best materials and finishes that suit your requirement, not because of what it costs. Because actually the architect is not a contractor. The architect is not going to be paid based on how much the building is going to cost. The architect is your consultant. He's a professional. He's there to advise you based on your needs. And at the end of the day, the architect is going to get a good name only if you are happy with what the building looks like finally and what it costs. So it's very important for the architect that you are happy with the building. So finally, the architect being involved means that you make less mistakes, you do less rework, and you get the best choice of materials and finishes within your budget. So it's here, it's just like a relationship is something just like a doctor or a chartered accountant or a lawyer, you know, you need to be transparent. Many people are like, I don't want to tell the budget to the architect because if I tell the budget, he'll use all the money. So be transparent, tell the architect, this is my budget. This is what I want to build in. And maybe even 10% lesser than this. Now, how do I go about it? With this understanding, the architect will tell you how to go about to achieve your budget. To ensure that, so at the end of the day, the architect is not pushing up your cost. And because the architect is involved, contractors and vendors will be more competitive because the architect knows the market rates. So they'll be more competitive in quoting, and that benefit again comes to you of whatever you save on that. And finally, the architect is there to ensure that your house is built as per your specifications, your drawings, and your aspirations, and that it, and the correct construction technology is followed. So he's your representative. So the that's intangible. So like we say, you know, the value of that is priceless. So with all of that put together, you actually save money rather than spend money when you hire an architect.
I agree with you, Mr. Ravi. So let's move on to our next question, which is very obvious, that at what stage should one begin consulting an architect?
Before you buy the land. So okay. At the stage when Mr. Balaji Badrinath enters the picture and he has shown the client multiple lands, saying that, you know, all these are fantastic options for you to buy. The client says, okay, I know that Coldwell Banker will do a fantastic job in checking the land, checking the antecedents, and making sure that I'm very safe and I go ahead with this deal. But of these options, which of these options is best for my need? Because sometimes when people buy the land, they don't communicate their final intent to the realtor as to what they want to do with it. And then they start building, they say, oh, it's too small, or it's not appropriately suited, or I wanted something different in a different location, or, you know, it happens because their aspirations come to the onto the paper only later. And then they feel they're compromising. Because as a realtor, you have done your job perfectly in terms of meeting their budget, in terms of meeting the location, and in terms of meeting all the specifications regard to the land and the facing and all that. But when they start building, they say, oh my God, this house is becoming very tight. I'm not able to achieve FAR. I'm not able to achieve within the bylaws. I cannot build the house that I aspire to build. So when all these concerns happen afterwards, it's too late. So when they, even when they're buying the land, they can get an architect to do a feasibility study. This is what I have in mind. This is my family. How much space do I need for my family to accommodate all of our interests, all of our needs? How much space do we need? With that understanding, will this plot work for me within the bylaws? Because as professionals, we always advise our clients follow the bylaws. Never put in yourself a situation where you are violating the bylaws and, you know, at a risk tomorrow. So clients end up violating bylaws only because they are not able to fit all their needs within the buildable area that is available to them as per the bylaws. So we can do a feasibility study even before they buy the land and say, of all the plots available to you, which one best meets your needs and aspirations, and which one will achieve, help you build the building that you need. So even at that stage, right at that stage, they can get a feasibility report done. And we restrict our feasibility purely to the architectural viewpoint in terms of what needs to be built. We don't get into the commercials. We don't get into the legality. Those are not our forte. So people like yourself at Coldwell Banker are the best people to advise them on those aspects. We focus on the architecture.
Got it. So my next question is, like, you know, there are multiple online media today that offer so many choices, images and designs on demand. In this scenario, why should one engage with an architect like you?
Yes, absolutely. In fact, yes, Instagram, Twitter, Google and Facebook, we have so many options available, so many choices available. But it's like saying that when I feel unwell, do I go online and Google my symptoms and take medicines based on that? Or should I consult a professional? Just as I would rather consult a professional where it comes to my health, I should consult a professional where it comes to my home. Because if I want to take a generic thing from the net or take a multiple set of images and try to put it together in a sort of a chaat masala, khichdi type of thing and put everything together and make a house, it is going to be as effective as trying to take a set of symptoms off the net and trying to medicate myself. So you know what you need, you know what you want, you know that you are getting value for money. So that is why, in spite of all these things being available, go ahead, share, tell the architect, I enjoyed this. I think this looks very good. I think your ideas or your needs to meet your requirements. So it's even more important in today's online thing to engage with an architect.
All right, sir. We move on to our final question, which is, how does design respond to COVID? How does design respond to pre-COVID and post-COVID scenario?
Excellent question, sir. Actually, it's very, very valid. I'm sure that you are also facing this type of thing where clients have started becoming very aware to the new normal. And the way we see it today, this is not going away. And even when it finally does go away, it will have changed the way we think, the way we react, the way we live. So in the COVID and post-COVID world, we are going to see a very, very different set of needs and requirements. For example, I was speaking earlier about flexibility. Now, wherever the house had that flexibility, that the house could have been converted to different needs, suddenly the house needs to become an office. Suddenly the house needs to become a school for children. Suddenly the house needs to become a health center where somebody is, you know, recuperating. And then you need to have privacy. At the same time, you want companionship. People need to be together, and yet people need to be separate when they're in their different meetings and classes. So similarly, you need to have personal and you need to have professional. So on one hand, you need a personal space, but also need to be completely professional when you're on an engagement, on working. So multiple requirements coming together in one space. And COVID has underlined this need for flexibility of space, that your space should be able to meet all your changing requirements. Today we are seeing COVID. Today we're living with it. We don't know what's coming. We don't know what the future holds. If your house is able to adapt to anything that is thrown at it, if it has that flexibility, then that family living in that house is that much happier, that much healthier, that much safer. And they've got the value for money because they didn't spend anything more in building that house. It's just that the architect was sensitive to their needs and to the possibilities while designing that house. That's how they got the value. So I think COVID is a good teacher in terms of how our lifestyles are changing. And I think we need to have houses that adapt to these changing lifestyles.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ravi, for this short with me today on this show. Dear friends, if you would like to get connected with Ravi, you would like to show your business card or you want to share some your contact screen, so that people can take a screenshot of it.
I can share that.
That's fine. So
yeah, I will.
Ravi's contact details and his website description is always pasted below. So please reach out to him if you need to. And friends, please comment on further questions, because these are all the basic questions which I've thought about asking to Mr. Ravi. You can always ask the questions which you think should be answered by an architect.